Hello, so in today's video we're going to be talking about my hero tier list for future class. Alright, we got it split up into S+, S, A, B, C, and F. This is just my opinion of the tier list based off of the champions or the heroes that are most used or that I see, you know, across all aspects of the game and not just for one particular aspect. So starting off is Renault. He's probably the most versatile hero and one of the highest, if not the highest, champions in the game. The reason he is so good, right, he's got two aspects. His Rhythm of War, which gives him 30% attack, crit, and crit damage at the start of the battle. And then his Barrage, which initiates at the start of the battle, right, so before any turns are taken, and it does massive amounts of damage with that additional attack and crit damage. This gets even more expounded with artifacts like the Flint Legacy. You know, if you go over to my artifact video, you can see why it's so good on him, and it boosts his damage even more with that high crit. And then once you get his exclusive up to level 20, it gives him an additional 60% damage and crit for the first three rounds, making his crit without any equipment or gems already at 90%. So he's almost guaranteed to hit those crits and do massive amounts of damage with his barrage. So next up on the list, we have Natasha. She's a powerful CC champion, you know, probably the best in the game. And the reason that is she's got Morphing Adaptation, which throws out freezing ice as long as more than three champions aren't CC'd, right? And that's at the beginning of the round, so it initiates before any enemies have a chance to take an action, and it can hit all the enemies, right? And it's got a chance. The other part that's really good with her is her Thunderbolt Blast, which can stun up to three targets. And that's her active ability or her ultimate. She's a great CC champ. She's got a shield that helps reduce damage to the highest attack hero, and overall one of the top tier champions for PvP and most aspects of the game, such as global and PE. So next up on the list we have Daisy. The reason she's so good, she's the best healer in the game. She's got Soul Stigma. This can be activated when she attacks, and it's also activated for the entire team when she uses her active ability or ultimate. So when taking fatal damage, it resists the fatal damage, so you don't die, and then you heal for 25% of your max troop capacity. Next on the list, we have Cantor. He's a great damage champion. He's probably towards the bottom of the S+ list. One of the reasons I have him on here is just because he's really good towards the beginning of the game. He falls off a little bit, but he's still really good throughout all phases. He's great as a total hero across PvP and PvE. One of the things that makes him so good, he's got Blue Flame Phoenix Fall, which builds C Flame stacks, which is his active ability, and it goes into a blue flame shower, which adds 20% damage reduction to all enemies, and he can also survive lethal damage. All right, so he builds C stacks, then he kind of throws a fireball that does really good damage based off the stacks that are built, right? And then also gives 20% damage reduction to all allies. And then it can survive lethal damage, so even though he does really good damage, you can put him on the front line. Right? He can help tank and then survive any lethal damage. So moving on to the S list, I have Vivian up first. She's the only hero on here that I listed that you can't use Universal Shards with. She's a VIP-only champion. That's the only way you can get shards with her is through the VIP packs. The biggest reason I put her on here is just because of her Master Builder ability. Reduction when she gets to 11 stars and has reduction to the construction time. Once you get towards end game content and you have things like your HQ level 30s, which take over 30 days base, that reduction, it saves you massive amounts of speed reductions and is just huge value added. The amount of diamonds you'll save over the entire game, or the amount of speed ups you'll save over the entire game, is astronomical. And that's, she, overall, she's just a really good champion too. She's got a lot of good abilities. She's really strong early game before you kind of have anyone else to unlock. Next on the list, I have O'Neal. You could argue he's an S plus champion. He's right, kind of right on the brink. I put him at S. With some of the things that makes him really good, right, is his Raging Shark, which is his ultimate or his active ability. He's got a 50% chance to stun three enemies if their troop capacity is above 40%. And if troop capacity is below 30%, right, he has a 100% chance to silence him. Another thing that makes him really good is all enemies at the beginning of the battle gain minus 10% attack, 20% defense. And the biggest thing that people use him for is a minus 15 or minus 15 speed to the enemy team. So next we have Marlon on the list. I paired him with Colin. Some of the things that makes him really good, both of them have Disarray Nemesis, which adds stamina reduction to their lineup. They can't be stacked together, so if you're using it for their stamina reduction, they need to be in separate lineups. And that pays a lot of dividends for events where you have to use stamina, whether it be Clash Verse or Strongest Warzone or any events that you're using stamina. You know, Dragons, all those events, that stamina reduction really helps out. That's just kind of an added bonus. Even without that, they're still very good heroes. They're some of the better CC heroes. They're the best SSR CC heroes, in my opinion. Colin's right on the border with Natasha. Marlon, he has a chance to stun the front line with his active ability Blazing Punch. 50% chance to stun there, and then a 35% chance to stun whenever he counterattacks. Right, so whenever anyone hits him, he counterattacks. Right, unless he dodges the attack or the attack doesn't hit him. But if the attack hits him, he does a counterattack, and that counterattack has a 35% chance to stun, which makes him that CC really good, you know, in all aspects of the game. Colin, she has an ability called Mental Disturbance, which has a 25% chance to stun. Right, so that works on her ultimate, which hits the entire enemy team. At the start of the battle, she has Chaotic Crash, which has a 50% chance to stun three enemies. And then her normal attack is paired with Child Talk, which has a 50% chance to inflict mental disturbance on front row enemies. So it hits all three front row enemies and 50% chance to activate mental disturbance, which does damage. And then on that mental disturbance would have a 25% chance to stun enemies in the front row. Next on the list, we have Norton. The reason he's so good is his anti-matter ability, which is his active ability. So what it does is it inflicts Annihilate, which does 30% of max troop capacity to the enemy, and it removes the enemy from the battlefield for 2 rounds. Now it's completely removed, so enemies like Bandito isn't able to use his Cleanse or his Dispel, or enemies like Anubis aren't able to cleanse CC and put shields on, and Forest Defender isn't able to attack your highest attack hero, even when he's, because normally he'll be able to do that even if he's stunned or frozen. That's the only way to pull Forest Defender from the battlefield to prevent him from attacking your highest attack heroes. Next on the list, we have Ryan. So Ryan, at the start of the battle, increases attack by 25% and speed by 25 for 5 rounds. So people will pair Ryan with Renault to try to get the Renault's speed up, so that if it's like a Renault versus Renault battle, that your Renault, either in that first round or next following rounds, will have a higher speed and be able to destroy or kill the other enemy Renault. He's a really good hero. You know, his abilities do reduce the enemy's defense as well. He's overall really good and just pairs well with a lot of abilities that you need to match speed with or try to get speed advantage over the enemy team. Next on the list, we have Constantine. He's sort of like Vivian. The biggest reason I have him on here is his research pioneer, right? With that massive reduction to research speed. Once again, it's just one of those things that is going to pay dividends in the speed ups that you have to use, right? So the amount of time it reduces, that battle power overall that you get, the amount of technology that you're going to be able to research is going to be greatly increased. It's a huge money saver in that. Other than that, he's still a really good champion, especially early game. His attacks kind of all work together to target the lowest troop power, or not troop power, but the lowest troop capacity. So whatever targets the lowest on health, he'll attack them. If it kills them, it'll give him an extra attack, right? And then it'll lead into his active ability. His active ability can kill enemies and then give him additional attacks, and he can just kind of chain that through and wipe an entire enemy team. Towards endgame, he really falls off just because his ability to kind of just wipe an entire team falls off. But that could also just be because people invest so much into Renault and researching into his type. You know, maybe if you researched into Constantine's type and you just stacked Constantine the way people do Renault, he could be very good in PvP, but he'll never be as good as Renault as an overall hero. The next I have on the list is Will. Some of the things that makes him really good is Divine Lasso, which he shares 40% of the damage taken with an ally with the highest attack. And he also has Divine Unicorn, which all allies get 40% defense for 5 rounds. And as he takes damage, the more damage he has taken, he gains more damage reductions the lower his health. All right, so that kind of pairs well with the taking 40% of the damage from the ally with the highest attack, so it just reduces damage to, you know, your damage dealer, and then as he takes more damage, he gets that higher damage reduction to take less damage. So then moving on to the A-list. If you've seen the A-list, if you're familiar with the World Boss, most of these heroes are World Boss heroes that people use with World Boss. That's kind of the biggest reason they're all in A-list. They're all really good champions otherwise. All right, one of the things that makes Kaylin such a strong hero, specifically for World Boss, is after her normal attack, she can perform up to 3 follow-up attacks. Those 3 follow-up attacks can trigger again. So they have a chance to trigger continuing follow-up attacks, right? And it can hit up to 20 times. So with her exclusive, we're not particularly talking about exclusives in this. I'm trying to keep it without exclusives, but it does pair very well with their exclusive, which reduces targets' damage reduction. So if an enemy has damage reduction in their kit or damage reduction, it's going to reduce that damage reduction, allowing her and your entire team to deal more damage. All right, on Starfall, her ability Starfall on casting Dazzling Slash, which is her active ability, right, or ultimate, she gains 35% crit rate and 60% crit damage. The reason I highlight this, right, is because of that Flint Legacy is based off of crit. So the more times you crit, it builds up attack. At, you know, the level 25 can build up to additional 100% attack. So that Flint Legacy works really well with her, particularly because of that additional crit that she has the ability to gain. Next on the list, I have Simone. One of the things that makes her good is at the beginning of the battle, she has 7 stacks of Gold Autumn Dream, right, to all of the allies. So Autumn Dream increases damage reduction by 3%, and then her attacks and different abilities have a chance to awaken those stacks. When those stacks are awakened, it increases the damage bonus of your heroes by 6%. At 3 stacks, it increases a crit. So 3 stacks of awakening, it increases a crit resist by 20%, and 7 stacks of awakening, it increases the bonus damage by 15%. All right, so it'll convert those stacks of Autumn Dream into Awakening, and then by the time all 7 of those stacks are awakened, they'll have 15% bonus damage, 20% crit resistance, and they'll still have damage reduction. Next on the list, we have Rika. Some of the things that makes her so good is her ability Voice of the Devil, right, which is her active ability or ultimate. In that, she has Sonic Boom, which increases all damage taken by an X percentage up to 300% for the rest of the battle, where X equals the total DB inflicted, right? So her attacks deal DB, right? It gives her DB stacks, and then when she uses her ultimate, it takes all those DB stacks and increases the damage that the enemy takes up to 300%. This is what makes her really good on World Boss, and it also just makes her good in a lot of aspects of the game. All right. In addition, she's got Guardian Angel, which at the start of the battle, all allies gain 16% damage reduction. Next on the list, we have Virgil. He's got Octave Chorus, so every 4 actions by allies causes sluggish sounds targets damage, right, which increases damage taken by 15%, and it can stack up to 60% and last 3 rounds. So whenever sluggish sound is triggered, you gain a stack of musical movement, and that musical movement can be turned into with the Melancholic Nocturne to increase the attack of the ally in the same row with the highest attack by 20% plus 10% for each stack of musical movement, right? So that sluggish sound, this works really good with Kaylin to get those sluggish sounds off, build up his musical movement, and to reduce or increase the damage taken by an enemy, as well as increase the attack of an ally in the same row. All right, next on the list, we have Lola. This is another World Boss champion. One of the things that makes her good is her swoop ability. So on an ally attack, she has a 35% chance to trigger a normal attack. So her normal attacks have overgrowth, which can give speed of allies is increased by 4 and attack by 4% for the rest of the battle. So this is stackable up to 60 times. So you could have your speed increased up to 240 and your attack by 240% by the end of the battle. This is kind of, once again, it's the 35%. This is why you'll see World Boss damage vary so much when you're using things like Lola and Kaylin, right, who have just percentage chances of things on their follow-up attacks. It's, you know, that RNG can have a huge range. So next on the list, we have Selena. She's not a World Boss champion. She's just a really good CC champion. She's right up there towards the top. A lot of people use her in their roster. And the reason that she's so good, right, even for just an SR champion, is that at the start of the battle, she has a 100% chance to freeze an enemy for a round. This 100% chance is typically the enemy that's directly across from her. So typically, you just line her up whoever you want to freeze in the front row. It's almost always a champion directly across from her in the front row for that 100%. But then, in addition, she also has a 80% chance to freeze an additional enemy. On top of that, after dealing damage, she reduces speed by 20% of the enemy she hits and has a 25% chance to freeze enemies for 2 rounds. And that's her attacks. Her attacks hit random enemies, and so there's no way to guarantee. It's just kind of random CC or random speed reduction. And that's another one of those RNG things. It could really turn around a fight. You know, if you get your damage or that speed or that freeze on somebody like Renault on the enemy team in PvP, it can completely change or win a battle for you. Next on the list, we have Weber. He's a really good champion. He's got an ability called Soul Cleanser. So 4 enemies That's his active ability. He hits four enemies and inflicts torn wounds for three rounds. So torn wounds. Sorry, whenever the target takes a critical hit from any hero on your team, they take a 150% attack bonus damage. They basically get an additional crit bonus damage on top of the crit damage bonus that they're already getting. So you'll see this if he's on the enemy team. You know, kind of a little thing pops up over your hero's heads, and then they take a bunch of extra damage, and it can really wipe your team out if you're not careful. Another thing that he has is Enraged Outpour. So every time he gets hit, he gets one stack of rage. Right, each time damage is taken, that rage increases his crit by 40% and his damage reduction by 20%. So this will stack up to two times. But when his rage stack hits four, all his rage is consumed. He goes into a berserk. Then he has 100% crit rate, 40% attack, and 40% damage reduction for three rounds. And if that matches up with that active ability, right, from his soul cleanser, it can really hurt, you know, the enemy team, because you got all that additional crit and crit damage. Next on the list, we have Yara. Right, so one of the things that makes her good is for the first five rounds, she dispels any debuff and CCs. She restores troop capacity, and she gains 30% attack and defense for each round. So right, for each of those five rounds, she's getting attack and defense. Her active ability, or ultimate, Coming Storm, removes most control effects from allies in the same row. So when she cleanses that CC at the beginning of the round, even if she's CC'd, right, for those first five rounds, and then let's say you know your Renault is CC'd, or any of your other champions that she's in the same row with are CC'd, she gets off her active ability and then removes a CC from those champions, and then they're able to use their attacks or their active abilities within that same round. So last on the list I have for A, I have Daryl. So the reason I have Daryl on here and not Byron specifically is right. For Daryl, he has an ability called Waiting Game. So whenever a hero dies, he deals 400% attack damage to an enemy with the lowest percentage of troops, which is nice, but that's not really what's really good about him. It's that Chokehold is whenever Waiting Game is activated. So whenever he gets an enemy dies and he hits the hero with the lowest troops, it reduces their energy by 20, right? So if they're just on the brink, or if they're in that same round, they're going to use their active ability or their ultimate, and then he hits them with Chokehold, right? It reduces their energy by 20, and then they're not going to be able to cast it that round. And then additionally, he has a 30% chance to inflict silence. His active ability, Dimensional Blast, attacks all enemies and does bonus damage to the targets with the fewest troop. And then if a target has less than 50% troops, it's going to deal an additional Waiting Game hit, right? So that if you get that Waiting Game hit, then you also activate Chokehold, and then it'll reduce their energy and buy you more time before they have their active abilities. So moving on to the B list, these are heroes that didn't quite make the A list. So we have Byron, who's in it. Probably the lowest SSR plus hero on this list, at least for me. He has Overload, which all enemies are attacked, or three enemies are attacked at random. Or all enemies are attacked, sorry. Three random enemies receive Spark. So Spark is an ability that Thunder Punch, anytime Thunder Punch or Byron attacks, it causes two additional enemies to take damage, right? So his active ability Overload adds Spark to three enemies, and then whenever he attacks that one of those enemies, if they have Spark on him, he'll do damage to two additional enemies. Allies also have a percentage chance to trigger Spark, and Lightning Induction also has a chance to activate Spark. So at the beginning of each round, he does 100% 20 damage to three enemies, right? And then that lightning induction has a 50% chance to inflict spark. So then if it hits an enemy, then it can deal damage to more enemies. Next, I have on the list Angi. So just quick note on here, it says Harvest and Divine Surge. So he doesn't have Divine Surge, he actually has Peacemaker, and that was a mistake when I was making this list. The thing that makes him, or you know, kind of has him on the B tier instead of the C tier, is really the only thing that kind of saves him from being lower is that his active ability Exterminate will attack the enemy with the highest attack, stunning them for 2 rounds. So it's a guaranteed way to get a stun off on the highest attack enemy. You don't have to worry about random hits or anything like that. It's one of the only 100% stuns in the game. Next on the list, we have Benito. So the kind of the thing that puts Benito here is he's got graceful defense, so all allies get 20% defense for the first 3 rounds, which is nice. But what really kind of puts him here is his endure. So whenever his health drops below 50% for the first time, he heals all allies and removes control status effects, and then makes them immune for the round. And additionally has Heavenly Smite, which removes damage. So that's his active ability. It removes damage over time effects on allies within the same round. But really, if you've played PE or anything else, or, you know, and you're going through in that PvE content, and you see a bit Benito, especially early on, when you're trying to rely on CC, you know, it completely just throws your game off. And the same thing can happen for your team. I've seen a couple people use them on PvP and actually save their team and wipe an enemy team, you know, that normally would have won. So next on the list, we have Ellie. She's the only R hero that I bothered to even list. She's a hero that most people use on World Boss. Overall, she's not bad. Early game, she's decent if you have no one else. She's a decent healer, but what really makes her good is she's got Grass Bond. It's going to link two teammates with the highest attack power, right? That gives them bonus damage. So, and then when one of them dies, the effect is removed. Next on here, we have Martina. She's a pretty good early game champion. She's really easy to get shards on, so she's one that you can kind of max up early in the game to kind of help out. She's really good early stages of the game for World Boss, but then just completely falls off, and by kind of late game, she's, I won't say useless, but she doesn't really have a lot going for her. You know, one of the things that she does is she's got Dazzling Shot, which at the end of the round, it randomly attacks up to 10 times and reduces the enemy's defense by up to 12%. Next on the list, we have Harley. He's a decent healer, but he's not really on the level, you know, of any of the other big healers out there, you know. I was able to get him up to 5 stars so far, but I really don't use him just because he doesn't offer that much. Some of the things he does have, though, is Musical Boost, right, which increases defense of all allies by 40%, which is pretty nice. So he's a decent, actually, he's actually an okay tank. And then he has Reverb on casting Crowd Goes Wild, which is his active ability or his ultimate. All allies get 20% damage reduction for 3 rounds. So it can kind of, if you're using them in a tank aspect, it can help with damage reduction, especially if you're matching other damage reduction, either artifacts or damage reduction abilities for some of the other heroes that we talked about. So C list, we're just going to kind of hit Justin. He's a decent tank for an SR hero. Kind of the thing that makes him okay is at the beginning of the battle, allies in the same row get 20% attack when his troop capacity is higher than 70%. So it kind of helped boost the damage at the beginning of the round. You know, I usually use him in a second or third lineup and kind of help match or pair typing. We got Katie and Maggie here. They're good damage in the early game. They're easy to star up. But after, you know, towards the late game, they don't really have anything to offer. The reason we have Burke down here is he's got no CC, right? It's kind of a tank hero. His damage isn't high enough to be a really good damage hero, and he doesn't really offer very much. For Matt Howard, Hannah's damage is not comparable to the other damage dealers we've talked about. They just really don't have enough to offer. One of the good things about Howard is he can hit backline heroes. That's something that Burke has also. His attacks can hit a backline hero. You know, but overall, they just don't have the damage output that other damage dealers have. All right. One thing about Billy is he can CC. So he's not a terrible hero, and he's okay to throw in there a match type. He doesn't have the CC that the other CC heroes or crowd control heroes we talked about, but he does have it, and you can throw him in there for matching type to try to get some crowd control, you know, in a second or third lineup in something like Pinnacle Battle or something like that. Roger does have a chance to give an ally an activated ability at the start of the match, so he'll boost their energy and they can have a chance to get their activated ability or their ult off the first round. Right, so you could have something like Renault Barrage, you know, before the start of the battle, and then Roger might increase his energy, and then he could, you know, get his another barrage off from his ultimate, and you could have two barrages in the same round and just completely, you know, wipe the enemy team. And then Amorous, he's a titanium miner, so he's good for out there mining titanium, but he also has a nice little execute ability, you know, when enemy's troop capacity falls below a certain percent. So all these F heroes, not really much going on for them. You can throw them in a lineup for things like Gold Digger, so when you're out there farming gold tiles or titanium miner, or when you're farming for titanium, or Agriculture Ambassador when you're farming for food. And so that covers the tier list. I'm sorry this is a super long video. You know, I wanted to make sure I kind of gave a reason why I placed everyone where they are. And this can hopefully kind of help you prioritize where you're spending those shards or how you're trying to level up your heroes. Make sure that you also check out my other videos. It'll give you a little more explanation on why these heroes are where they're at, especially things like the artifact video and the hero club video will help you understand which artifacts to use with them and then how to, you know, really level up your heroes using the hero club.